Hi everyone and welcome to the Unacademy YouTube channel. So this is a one-of-a-kind new series that we are starting with, that is keeping in mind the next pattern. So this is a gynae path correlation. I'm Dr. Preeti Sharma. I'm your pathology educator on the platform of Unacademy. And with me today, we have one of our top educators of gynecology, that is Dr. Ramya, who's going to teach us a lot about something in gynecology which gets you a lot of questions, and that is infections. So while she will enlighten us about the infections that you can get, I will enlighten you about the pap smear findings that you have associated with them. So before we begin with this particular gynepath series, ma'am, I would want you to enlighten the students over here that how the pattern has now probably changing from NEET to NEXT, although still in a draft phase. But what is your take on that?
So as we all know that we are having the NEET going into NEXT. So basically the NEXT is nothing but where we are going to have the integration, vertical integration of the different subjects into your final year subjects. So we are going to give you one example of that, how pathology can be integrated and asked as an MCQ for you in the obstetrics and gynecology. So not wasting much time, we'll start with today's session where we are going to discuss some of the MCQs, where we are going to have the pathology integration inside the obstetrics and gynecology.
Okay, so ma'am, you mean to say first we'll start off with the clinical history and then we'll integrate it with the pathology slide?
Yes.
That's what the students should expect. So, okay, that sounds very interesting, ma'am. Please, let's start with case number one. Ma'am, please let us know what is the clinical history that we have.
So, we'll just go through the first case. We have a 35-year-old woman presents to the general practitioner. She has come to you with offensive vaginal discharge. The discharge is associated with dysuria and vulval itching. A gynecological examination is unremarkable. High vaginal swab and endocervical swabs are taken for microbiological testing. Results are awaited. The results shown is as in the image below. So what is your diagnosis? So here, if you understand the question, they are telling you that we have a patient with offensive vaginal discharge, dysuria, vulval itching, and we got an image which we have to interpret. So image interpretation, I think Dr. Preeti will be best to interpret the image. So over to you, Preeti.
Perfect, ma'am. The history seems quite interesting. So I'll show the students different areas of this pap smear that we have. So in one particular area, all of you can appreciate that we can see these epithelial cells. So first and foremost, you have these cells. And then the second most striking and, you know, glaring portion of this particular image is something known as polyballs. Now, what are polyballs? If you just break the term into two, balls would basically mean clusters and poly would mean polymorphs. So these are clusters of polymorphs. What do I mean by polymorphs? Means all the neutrophils. So you can see there's one cluster of neutrophils over here. There's another cluster of neutrophils forming over here. So that was one end of the slide, ma'am, that was showing us. It is showing us clusters of polymorphonuclear cells. So when we shifted our view to the other areas of the slide, this is what we started seeing. So there were areas which were showing us these well-keratinized squamous epithelial cells. And then these three organisms that I've encircled. Now, you know, for the students, it's very difficult to catch it at such a low power. We as pathologists are very experienced to do that. So I guess the students will be best able to appreciate it when we zoom into them. So we can see that there are these organisms that are seen, which we classically call as the pear-shaped organisms. And you know, as a theoretical question, their size is somewhere between 15 to 30 microns. And you know, if the students kind of just strain their eyes a little, there's a very small and a very thin structure or a flagella that seems to be coming out, which very, you know, is not very well appreciable, but the pear shaped is the one that they have to look out for. So let me show them another picture. So very clearly over here, they can see these pear shaped organisms. And you know, the concept of this integrated series was that we wanted to give the students a lot of variety. So once a question also came that yes, pear shaped is trichomonas, and that is what our diagnosis is, but there's another shape that it can get, and that is, it can also look like a kite-shaped organism. So that is another variation that I want to tell the students, that you can get a kite-shaped morphology also with the presence of these granules present inside the cytoplasm. So when all of this was clubbed together, ma'am, we saw polyballs, we saw these organisms. So from my end, I would have reported it as a trichomonas infection, but certainly in the history, it correlates well with the history that you have provided. But you had mentioned that the gynecological examination was unremarkable. So is there any other thing that I can probably, maybe in another patient, I could have got something very specific in that gynecological examination? Something from your side?
So that was a wonderful pictures which we saw. So we had a very good pictures where we saw the trichomonas so beautifully. And yes, the history also correlates that it is a trichomonas vaginitis, because in the history they told us we had discharge. In the history they didn't give you the color of the discharge, but trichomonas normally presents to you with greenish colored discharge. Next, they always have itching associated. And in our question also in the history, we had the patient telling to us that there is itching. Next, they also have dysuria. So yes, in our patient also, we had dysuria. And normally, we also have dyspareunia, that is the difficulty in the coitus. Although in this patient, it was unremarkable on the speculum examination. But normally, when we do speculum examination, a characteristic finding of trichomonas is you have strawberry vagina and strawberry cervix. It's also described as an angry looking vagina because of the inflammation. It looks like a red color. So we'll see a picture where we can see this strawberry vagina, strawberry cervix. So this is a beautiful picture where we are seeing the cervix with red colored dots, which is looking like a strawberry. So that is how normally we see it.
That is what I was wanting to know, because earlier in our, although in our history, ma'am, it said that the gynecological examination was unremarkable, but I think this is a beautiful picture, which is a very common presentation, I suppose, of these patients. So yes. That's rather a very, and you know, there are many other strawberry appearances also that we have, but before that, just a pathological correlation, I want to tell the students that, you know, one particular organism, although we did not see it in this slide, but one particular finding that we can see with trichomonas very commonly is the leptothrix organism. So these extremely slender looking structures that you have all over the slide, that's a very common association, ma'am, that we can see with trichomonas. So when leptothrix and trichomonas are present together, this has been given the spaghetti and meatball appearance. This is a fancy name that is given to it. So the spaghetti is obviously these thin filamentous leptothrix, and the meatball becomes those pear-shaped trichomonas. And you know, I would really encourage all the students to let us know in the live chat box that where else can we see the spaghetti and meatball appearance. It's a very important collateral information that we study in microbiology. So we'll wait for your answers, and I hope all of you are able to recall from micro as well as dermat that this is also seen with an infection that is Malassezia. So with Tinea versicolor, we see a similar spaghetti and meatball appearance, and this is another place that we are seeing that. So although, ma'am, this was not seen in our case, but just wanted to tell the students that these two organisms are very commonly seen. So ma'am,
so that is wonderful. The diagnosis.
You have to treat the patient now.
So that was wonderful. We have integrated this along with the micro also. So we had a microbiology integration also. I think that's a great point, Preeti. Yes. So how do we treat this? So the treatment of trichomonas has been asked as an MCQ many, many, many times in our previous AIMS questions as well as NEET question. Past 1 to 2 years, every paper we are getting this question. So I would like to tell you what is the investigation of choice, treatment, everything. So investigation of choice is saline microscopy, where we can see the pear-shaped cells, pear-shaped organisms moving forward with the flagella. Gold standard is culture on the Feinberg's Whittington's media or the Diamond's media. The drug of choice is metronidazole. The drug of choice is metronidazole. According to CDC, the dose which we have to give is metronidazole 2 grams single dose, or we can give alternative, that is tinidazole 2 grams orally a single dose. Alternate regimen to that is metronidazole 500 milligrams twice daily for 7 days. The question which was asked in AIMS last year was, what is the drug of choice for metronidazole? Sorry, what is the drug of choice for trichomoniasis in pregnancy? So the drug of choice for trichomoniasis in pregnancy is also metronidazole. So that was asked in the exam. A very important point is your trichomoniasis is the sexually transmitted disease. So you have to treat both the partners. So both partners need to be treated, right? So we'll also see the management of this in the pregnancy, as there was a question on that. So in the first trimester, I avoid giving the tablet of metronidazole, but I can give metronidazole pessaries. So it will be locally acting. So first trimester, we can give metronidazole pessaries. Whereas second and third trimester, we give metronidazole 2 grams stat dose, or we can give 250 milligrams thrice daily for 5 days. So that is everything about the trichomoniasis, where we discussed about the pathological correlation as well as about the infection per se. So any other points you would like to add to this?
Certainly, ma'am. I think finally our patient is treated, but our MCQ is not over for the students. And since this is an integrated session, I thought, why not tell the students quickly? And in fact, it will be a good revision for them also, since we've just spoken about, you know, the angry cervix that you were telling us about, that is the strawberry appearance of the cervix that you see in trichomonas. I thought, why not discuss all the different other strawberry appearances, a quick overview in a minute on the same. So I think a favorite with the students is the strawberry tongue, and this is seen in two particular diseases which they get a question on. One of them is a vasculitis, so that is the Kawasaki disease. And the other is a scarlet fever. So scarlet fever and Kawasaki disease is where we see a strawberry tongue. Now, within the oral cavity only, other than the tongue, if we see strawberry gums, that is something we see in another vasculitis, that is Wegener's granulomatosis. So many a times we remember it with this mnemonic, G for gums and G for granulomatosis, that is where you see the strawberry gums appearance. Now, a question that comes up in dermatology is, where do you see the strawberry angioma or strawberry hemangioma? So, you know, a question that they get, so you can very clearly, we can appreciate there is this reddish lesion that is present on the cheek of this child. So that is a type of a capillary hemangioma. That's also a question that has come in the previous year paper. So that's another correlation. Also, another one which is a radiological correlation, which I suppose, ma'am, you must have seen sometimes in females who have a fetal, some chromosomal abnormality. So a strawberry skull is something we see in trisomy 18, that is Edwards syndrome. And also, not to leave aside surgery, I'm sure all the students have guessed it by now, that strawberry gallbladder is something we see in when there is cholesterol deposition in the gallbladder, that is cholesterolosis. So since it was an integrated session, I thought, why not put in all the different strawberry appearances also in order to complete our case. With which, ma'am, we finished our first case, and I hope the students have benefited with it. So I would request you to move on to the next infection and give us another history so that we can guess the next one as well.
So, right, let's go to the next question. So, a 25-year-old woman presents to the general practitioner in the second trimester with a whitish vaginal discharge. The discharge is associated with vulval itching. The pars speculum and pap smear findings are shown below. What is the diagnosis? So, I think pap smear and pars speculum I can comment on. So, here we see on the pars speculum, the curdy white discharge, the classical curdy white discharge. This itself tells us something, but let's also see the pap smear right after this.
Okay, so that's
Dr. Preeti can comment on the pap smear.
Correct. I'll go ahead with the pap smear, and usually, you know, we only get this written on our forms in the pathology lab. So it's really good to see it actually, that, you know, how you sent it from the patient. So moving ahead, this is one of the most classical fancy names that you get in a pap smear. And I think all the students know that, you know, when we've, you've already, ma'am, you've showed us the curdy white discharge and the history that you've provided us. And now I'm saying that this is something known as the sheesh kebab effect. I'm sure all the students have guessed that we are dealing with candida. So I'll just quickly show a few pictures of this sheesh kebab effect, which they get in the exam. So as the word suggests, it's pretty much self-explanatory. So there's going to be these pseudo hyphae. There are these pseudo hyphae, and around them, like pieces of kebabs, there are those epithelial cells that are there. Let me show you another picture. So this is a picture that has been taken up directly from the Bethesda book, which is the standard book that we have for pap smears. So if you see, all the epithelial cells are arranged back to back, as if like I told you, the sheesh kebab effect. So one behind the other, all of them are arranged. And what are they, what is holding them together? What is that skew that is holding them together? That is the pseudohyphae. That is why we are dealing with candida. So this is the classical sheesh kebab effect that we see. And that's another picture that has actually come in one of the previous year papers. So this was the pseudohyphae. And these are all the epithelial cells which are clustered together like a sheesh kebab effect. So that is one finding that we see in the epithelial cells, that they tend to cluster together. But I'm sure the students want to look at the organism also. So both the forms of the organism we can see in this picture. These elongated structures, these are the pseudohyphae, as well as these budding forms. These budding forms that we see, these are the budding leaves. So we can see pseudohyphae also. Those pseudohyphae will be the ones on which those kebab pieces would be kept, that is the epithelial cells will be kept to create the sheesh kebab effect. And then we can see the budding yeast also. And I'm sure, ma'am, you always talk about a wet mount. So a wet mount also shows us these budding forms. I think the students can very well appreciate the budding forms on this wet mount. So that is something from my side with this sheesh kebab effect, with the budding forms, with the pseudohyphae. I think it's a very classical case with the curdivide discharge of candidiasis. So ma'am, over to you. Now you need to treat the patient for us.
So as ma'am has shown wonderful pictures of the candidiasis. So now we'll speak few words about the candidiasis. So candidiasis is mainly caused by Candida albicans, but it is not just caused by Candida albicans. Other forms of Candida can also cause candidiasis. So the other forms of candidiasis, which can cause candidiasis, are Candida galbraithae and Candida tropicalis. But now a very, very important point. In the history also, if you have observed, the patient has come to you with vaginitis in pregnancy. Candida is the only organism which can flourish in the acidic medium. And during pregnancy, we have least acidic pH. That's around 3.5 to 4.5. So Candida is the only organism which can grow in the acidic medium. So it is the most common vaginitis, which is seen in pregnancy, which is seen in diabetics, and which is seen in immunocompromised. If we go to see the clinical picture, they come to you with a classical history that they will have curdivide discharge and itching. There's a lot of itching also. So like we had in this patient, white discharge and itching. Next, we also saw the saline mount, so where you can see the pseudohyphae and budding yeast. Good standard for this is Culturon Saveroids Agar. Drug of choice for this is any antifungals, mainly the azole group we give. And the main drug of choice according to CDC is giving the fluconazole, 150 milligrams a stat dose. If somebody asks you what is the management of candidiasis in pregnancy, the answer remains again the same, that is fluconazole 150 milligrams stat. But you have to avoid fluconazole in the first trimester. You can go for either local ointments with clotrimoxazole or miconazole in the first trimester. Second and third trimester, we can give fluconazole 150 milligrams stat dose. So that is in short about the candidiasis, the most important points which you should be knowing about the candidiasis. And those were a brilliant images which we saw about candidiasis. And I'm lucky enough that I'm able to see all these images. Oh, it's refreshing my memory also.
I hope as much as we are benefiting from this discussion, I hope the students are as well and they are liking this integrated session. So I guess, ma'am, we can go on to the last clinical scenario that we have for today. And that's the next question that we have for the students. Please let us know what are we dealing with now.
So here we see a 40-year-old woman presented to the gynecologist with complaints of profuse vaginal discharge. There is no discharge from the cervix on speculum examination. The diagnosis of bacterial vaginosis was made. Based upon all of the findings on microscopy, except, so although the question is telling about something, a gynecological question where we are having bacterial vaginosis, the diagnosis is already done. But here, basically, if you go deep into the question, they're mainly asking you microscopy, right? So here, abundance of gram-variable coccobacilli, absence of lactobacilli, abundance of polymorphs, presence of clue cells. I think Dr. Preeti can enlighten us about each one of the findings.
This is the perfect example of what we are targeting in the next, because this started off as a gynecology question. Somewhere in between, they've given us a, you know, the diagnosis also. And then they jumped on to the pathology part of it, and that is what the integrated session. I think this gives the best example to the students of how questions are expected. So I guess the students should get their answer as we start discussing, and I'll start with the last option that is written over here, something known as presence of clue cells. So yes, that is a true statement. That is something we see in bacterial vaginosis. So first, let's see a schematic diagram. What exactly should you expect from a clue cell? Why do I say clue? Because it's giving you a clue towards something. It's giving you a clue towards the bacterial vaginosis. So if this is a normal epithelial cell, we can see a normal cell, we can see a normal nucleus in the center. But then something changes over here. To that cell, there is some cocoa bacilli which are coming and sticking onto them. So when they come and stick onto these, certainly they are giving us a clue. They are giving us a clue towards bacterial vaginosis. So if you've understood the schematic picture, you should be able to understand the real-time microscopic picture. So we've got both things in a similar field. So in the first picture out here, we can see a normal epithelial cell, a nice polygonal cell with a central nucleus. We don't see too many cocoa bacilli that are sticking onto it versus this particular cell that we have over here. I can barely appreciate the underlying epithelial cell because it is studded with these, if you look very closely, it is studded with these tiny round, cocoa and bacilli. So they are going to be round as well as rod shaped. So they are going to be cocoa bacilli which are completely filling up or completely covering this cell. I can hardly see the underlying morphology. And that is why it is giving us a clue. It is giving us a clue towards bacterial vaginosis, and that is why I call it a clue cell. So this is one of the most important features that we see in a case of bacterial vaginosis. And I guess the background, also something, ma'am, that you had mentioned in the question, this was something written in one of the options. We in the background, we are not seeing polymorphs. We are not seeing the polymorphs in this background. So first, we see most importantly what gives us a clue are these clue cells. So ma'am, if you could please tell us about this criteria that you follow, that is the AMCLS criteria.
So clue cells, AMCLS criteria, these are something which have been asked many, many times. It's like multiple times have been repeated from past 5 to 10 years. So that was a wonderful picture of the clue cells which we saw. And now coming to the AMCLS criteria. So to call it as AMCLS criteria, you should have 3 out of 4 positive. So what are those 4 things which you should have in the AMCLS criteria is dirty, white, foul smelling discharge, pH more than 4.5. When you apply 10% KOH, you'll have fishy odor because of the release of amines and putrescine. That is called as whiff test positive. And clue cells should be positive. Clue cells should be seen. So when you have all this, we call it as AMCLS criteria. Right? And that is one of the very diagnostic criteria for bacterial vaginosis.
3 out of 4 of these is what you're saying for the AMCLS criteria.
So we should have at least 3 out of 4 to be positive to call it as AMCLS criteria.
Okay. So what about the basics about this, ma'am? What is the etiology like?
Right. So bacterial vaginosis, it is mainly the alteration of the microflora in the vagina. So I never tell that bacterial vaginosis is caused by some organism. It is more than caused by some organism. It is alteration of the microflora. That is, your anaerobic bacteria or pathogenic bacteria are increasing and your good bacteria, that is the lactobacilli, is going to decrease. So etiologically, what are the main bacteria which are causing this bacterial vaginosis are Gardnerella vaginalis, which is most common, Mycoplasma, Peptostreptococci, and Bacteroides. So there was one question where they asked what are the other organisms which can be associated with bacterial vaginosis. So it's better to know the other organisms also. But you should be knowing that there are many more anaerobic bacteria which can cause. Now coming to the symptoms. Symptoms, you will have dirty, white, malodorous discharge. Please understand a very important point. We have just discussed 2 things here, bacterial vaginosis and candidiasis. Bacterial vaginosis and candidiasis had, along with the discharge, itching. But your trichomoniasis and candidiasis, both of them had itching. But bacterial vaginosis does not have vulval itching. Okay. Now, why don't they have vulval itching is there is no proper inflammation in bacterial vaginosis. And as there is no inflammation, you don't have associated itching in the bacterial vaginosis.
Okay, okay. So that is something even I've learned. That's great, ma'am. So what is the scoring and the treatment that we go out with?
So diagnosis is by AMSELS criteria, but you also have something called as Nugent scoring. In the Nugent scoring, we see how many lactobacilli do we have and how much percentage of Gardnerella do we have. So if the Gardnerella is increased and lactobacilli is decreased, then we call this as bacterial vaginosis. So it is not just mere presence of Gardnerella tells me that it is a diagnosis of bacterial vaginosis. It is the percentage of your lactobacilli and Gardnerella together we take into account to call it as bacterial vaginosis. So Gardnerella should be increased and lactobacilli should be decreased to call it as bacterial vaginosis. So this is something about our question, a clue for our question as well. Coming to the treatment, treatment is metronidazole 500 milligrams twice daily for 7 days. So even for trichomoniasis as well as bacterial vaginosis, both the treatment is metronidazole. Okay. So we go back to the question.
Yes, we let's get back to the question. Let's attempt it once again so that now the students are aware of what all did we have to know about this. So ma'am, I would say that, why don't you take it up and you let us know the answer to the students.
So as we have seen the picture and as I told you in the Nugent scoring also, so abundance of gram variable cocobacilli, that is nothing but the Gardnerella, should be more, and along with that we should have absence of lactobacilli. Yes, absence of lactobacilli also tells us that we are dealing with bacterial vaginosis. And ma'am already told us that we should have definitely presence of Clusens. So what is not required to make the diagnosis of bacterial vaginosis? That is abundance of polymorphs. So we don't see the polymorphs in the microscopy of bacterial vaginosis. So this was a previous year question.
Okay, that's great. So we solved that question. And also before we end this session, ma'am, there is a query which students, I'm sure they must have come up to you with that query a couple of times. And that is the slide of clue cells. They tend to confuse it with another organism. And let me show that organism. I'm sure it's a confusion which many students have. And that is a slide of actinomyces. So, there's one very simple clue that I have been following ever since is that whenever I get confused, because what you see over here, this ball-like structure, this is actually an actinomycin. So how do I look out and how do I differentiate that, whether it is something, whether these are cocobacilli sticking on a cell, are they clue cells, or is it a cluster of actinomyces? So look at the periphery. Appreciate the periphery because actinomyces gives us something known as cotton ball clusters. They are known as cotton ball clusters, also known as the woolly ball clusters and also known as the woolly body clusters. So they're basically like the fibers of cotton, like the fibers of wool. They are very fine filamentous structures that you will see projecting from the periphery. And that's a very important hint that we should take out. When you see these filamentous structures coming out at the periphery, just like a cotton ball, that is actually actinomyces. So we should not confuse it with those clue cells that we had. And ma'am, if I'm not wrong, actinomyces is an infection which we very commonly see with the intrauterine contraceptive devices, correct?
Yeah, that's correct. So actinomyces is something which is most common organism associated with the intrauterine device users as well. I think we also can make points about the actinomyces. Actinomyces is the only organism which produces the sulfur granules. And we also call it as sunray appearance. Yes. I think that sunray appearance somewhere to this also we can match it. For actinomyces?
Certainly, that those filaments that are coming out at the periphery. Yeah. So that is actually very well and better appreciable on a histopath slide. But yes, that is an appearance we say for actinomyces certainly. And I'm sure the students have got this question in the previous years also because sunray appearance is a classical one for actinomyces that we have. So I guess, ma'am, with this, we have ended at least a short but a very important topic that we had, that was infections in gynepath, which were pertinent to pap smear. So thank you so much for enlightening us. And anything you want to tell the students before we end this session, how should they go about with their next preparation?
Right. So this is one of the example how we integrate the subject. And no subject you can learn directly. You always have to go step by step. That is what is the main thing which they're going to do in the next also. So basically, we should have our basics more strong in order to answer the final year subjects. So that is why learning in an integrated process is something very important, and that is what we are trying to do here also. And thank you guys. So if you liked our video as well, if you want us to do some more integrated topics, so definitely let us know in the comment box. And I think we'll come up more with such innovative integrated sessions. Right,
yes.
Dr.
Preeti? Yes, and I guess let's leave it to the students only so that they can let us know what are the topics they are facing a difficulty with, because we might not think from the same perspective as theirs. So whatever topics they are having a problem with, be it oncology like ovarian tumors, endometrial tumors, or maybe cervical lesions, or whatever problems or obstacles you are facing, so you can write it down to us in the comment section or even on the Telegram group of Fun Academy. And we will certainly come up with many more sessions like this, also with other subjects and other educators. So certainly feedback from you will be very important out here so that we know what are the topics that you are looking out for. So thank you so much for joining in. I hope all of you had a fruitful discussion and you gathered something out of this. And also thank you so much, ma'am, for teaching me gynecology today, because I have only been looking at slides, and it's been a while that I've seen the clinical part of it. So it was certainly very enlightening for me as well. Thank you so much,
ma'am. Thank you, ma'am. Thank you. As well, I have learned many new things today. So thank you, guys. See you again in the next session. Thank you, ma'am.
Okay, bye-bye.